Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2023. Agenda item one is a declaration of interests, and as this is the first meeting of Stuart McMillan attending as a new member of the committee, I'd like to welcome Stuart to the committee and invite him to declare any registrable interests that are relevant to the committee's remit.
Thank you, Convener. I got no interest to declare.
Thank you very much. This morning, we are going to take evidence from members of the Scottish Government Standing Committee on Pandemic Preparedness, and I would like to welcome to the meeting Professor Andrew Morris, who is the Chair of the Standing Committee on Pandemic Preparedness. Professor Morris is also the Director and CEO of Health Data Research UK and the Vice Principal of Data Science at the University of Edinburgh. Good morning, Professor Morris. I'd also like to welcome to the meeting Professor Tom Evans, who is a Professor of Molecular Microbiology and a Consultant in Infectious Diseases at the University of Glasgow. And thank you very much for attending this morning.
Good morning.
Now, we estimate the session will run up to 10:30 a.m. and each member will have approximately 10 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak, and I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much and I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interests of brevity. So I'll now turn to the questions and I begin. I'd like to ask the first question, gentlemen, is what meetings have been held with the activity and what activity has the committee undertaken over the past 6 months?
Good morning.
Good morning.
And on behalf of Tom and I, it's great to be here in person after our previous technology challenges. So over the past 6 months, the committee has met three times. We're actually meeting next week as well. But there are two comments I'd like to make. Firstly, we're in the sort of detailed analysis phase. Having set out the stall, we need granularity and detail. So we've set up three so-called short-life working groups, which are interdisciplinary, to look at three areas that we feel really need greater definition. And the first of those are on data. So we've called it the Scottish Data for Pandemic Preparedness Oversight Group, chaired by Professor Dame Anna Dominicek. The second one, really important, we've recommended a Centre for Pandemic Preparedness. So we've set up a subgroup on pandemic, on what that centre would do, how it would be led, and how we might suggest it is governed. And then thirdly, we have a group on behavioural intervention and community engagement. Because as you know, the social contract in Scotland is so important, and working with the publics and communicating with the publics. Those are the three groups. The other thing I would like to highlight is, because as the independent chair of this group, it's really important that we're outward looking. Pandemics are global. So the exam question is, how does Scotland position itself in a global ecosystem of pandemic preparedness, working with the UK and internationally? So we set up an international steering group, which met on the 10th of November. It's Bijou, but we've got three fantastic members. We've got Sir David Nabarro, who is Chair of Global Health at Imperial's Institute of Global Health Innovation. But he was also asked by the WHO Director General to be his special envoy in March 2020. We have Jeremy Farrar, who was formerly Director of the Wellcome Trust, is now Chief Scientist for the World Health Organization. And we have Camilla Stoltenberg, the Director General of the Norwegian Institute of Public Health. So that group has met, and I'm happy, Tom and I would be happy to provide feedback from any of those activities that are of interest to the committee.
I think this will be a fascinating session. Thank you. When do you expect the final report to be published?
We intend to be on time. and on budget. So the guidelines were set by the First Minister's Commission, the request was the final report to be published within 18 months of the interim report. So that would be February 2024. But we hope to publish the report in the fourth quarter of this year. Okay. So we've got another seven, 8 months.
Okay. I'm going to ask one final small question. I hope this is a small question. before I go on to other members of the panel. The UK Resilience Framework, All Risks and Civil Contingencies, could you expand on what that is?
Do you want to pick that one up?
So, I mean, there are a number of other groups, obviously, working across the UK and, indeed, as Andrew said, internationally. I've been involved a bit with the Emergency Preparedness and Clinical Countermeasures Group, which is organised as a Four Nations group, but is organised out of the Department of Health and Social Care in London. And they've really directed towards a number of different issues to do with pandemic preparedness, epidemiology modelling, what kind of diseases might become pandemic, disease X, what do we need to think about? To think about the infrastructure needed to deal with a pandemic in terms of diagnostics, testing, surveillance and so forth. And then issues to do with provision of personal protective equipment in healthcare, what do we need to think about getting? And also in terms of medicines in particular, what agents might the United Kingdom think about stockpiling? And where do we need to think about procurement and so forth? Clearly, some of these issues overlap with the work of our committee, and we certainly want to make sure that everything we do is relevant to Scotland. That's really key. But absolutely, we need to be integrated into the United Kingdom's response and also, indeed, internationally. And I should say that international reference group has been hugely helpful in terms of you know, making sure that we align to best practice internationally and not to be precious about our own ideas and so forth, so to make sure that we leverage all that help that we can get. So there is potential overlap here, but as much as we possibly can, we work collaboratively with all these different institutions, UK Health Security Agency as well.
Yeah, I was going to say, there may well be overlap, but it's better to have overlap as miss something.
Absolutely.
Okay. I'm going to move on to other members, and Murdo, I'll pass that to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Professor Morris, Professor Evans. Professor Morris, you'll remember when we saw you back in September on that session that was plagued by internet problems, so it's good to see you in person. At that point, you'd published your interim report, and we asked you if you'd had a response from the Scottish Government at that point. I think the answer at that point was you hadn't had one, although you were hoping to get one. Has there been one yet that you can tell us about?
Yes, there has. So on the 8th of December, the former First Minister wrote to me as the independent chair, and I'm happy to summarise the... And I'd also be happy, because key to this is transparency, yeah. So we're very keen to publish everything. So we should definitely ensure that that is in the public domain. But key points from the response, firstly, recognising, there are increasing demands on government. Despite that, there was a commitment to prepare for the future. Secondly, the First Minister confirmed that she accepted our interim recommendations. Thirdly, she expressed an interest at that time to meet the International Reference Group, which we should revisit. And then two other comments. She recognised the urgency of the importance of surveillance data and analytics and the necessity for Scotland in the future to have a core data infrastructure, which will actually enable pandemic preparedness. And she noted the urgency of that and asked us to push on that agenda as quickly as possible. And finally, at that time, she asked the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, Mr. Yusuf, to take forward the work necessary. So those were the conclusions of the letter.
Okay, thank you. And I mean, that was back in December. Have you been following that with the Scottish Government? You say that they said they accepted all your recommendations. Are you aware that they're taking work forward on this?
The way the group's constituted, because I'm an independent chair, you know, I've got a day job. So a learning from the pandemic was deep collaboration across science, service delivery, NHS, industry and policymakers. So the way we've constituted the group is that we have Scottish Government representation on the group. So I see it as a continuous process rather than a periodic, here's our report, what, you know, although it is an independent report to government. In my view, to make it the best quality product requires ongoing dialogue. For example, the chief scientific advisor is on the group. For example, we get great support from the deputy director who has oversight of Public Health Scotland on the group. And I think that's, you know, that's a more dynamic approach. So I see it as continuous rather than sort of periodic.
Yeah, so it's a work in progress.
Yeah.
Okay. So I suppose in light of that, then, the interesting question for this committee is, what is the state of readiness, in your view, of Scotland, should we have another pandemic? So perish the thought, you know, next year another pandemic comes along. Do you think we are now in a better place to handle a pandemic than we were pre-COVID? Or, and if we're not, what more need we do to be there?
Do you want, this is an important question. We maybe both take
it. Yeah, of course.
Is that okay?
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's a very important question. We're certainly in a better place than we were before COVID, without question. We've learned so much. Yeah. If I were marking the current response, I'd give it a B. And that's partly why we have this committee, because what we're trying to do is to ensure that we elevate that mark to an A. So across a number of things, there are clearly things that we need to do better. They all interrelate. The data infrastructure is critical. You know, we did really well with that. Scotland contributed hugely, both in analysis of data, participating in clinical trials and so forth, where I think, you know, we really were world leading in that. And I use the term advisedly because it's often overused, but that was a really key part of our response. The danger is that that falls by the wayside as other things take precedence, quite understandably. So it's really important that that's, you know, absolutely embedded in infrastructure, that we accept we can't be at a pandemic level the whole time, but that the mechanisms, the ways of ensuring that clinicians and others can set up trials very readily, that the data can be acquired without losing public trust in their data, because we enjoy a very high level of public trust in the health service in Scotland, and we must make sure that that's protected, but at the same time oil the wheels to make sure that that can always be you know, we can get the data, analyse it as quickly as we can. I think the other issue that was highlighted in our interim report was in ensuring that the right advice and independent advice is available and rapidly available as well. And again, I think we're moving in the right direction there. And I think we learnt a lot, certainly I learnt a lot about on a variety of scientific advisory committees on the sort of advice that's useful and who you need to have. And again, we're working towards that. And then I think this linkage between, we call it others have called it the triple helix, between academics, between public health and industry. You know, we've got a good life sciences industrial base in Scotland and in the United Kingdom. And really to ensure that that can continue, we can get the most out of it in terms of a future pandemic is really vital. And again, we can't have labs sitting empty, factories sitting empty. So they have to be purposed for something that else while able to react to that once that's called on. You may have read that Moderna, the very large American vaccine company, is situating a plant within the United Kingdom, which is very welcome. And I think anything that can be done to reinforce those interactions, which are so fruitful during during COVID-19, will be very welcome. So those, I think, are some of the areas that we're certainly working towards. Okay.
Tom's covered that very eloquently. There is a cultural dimension to this, and I do worry about complacency. The geopolitical and economic pressures are immense globally, but we mustn't forget the pain the pandemic caused. And I do worry about complacency that, you know, COVID's done or pandemics are done. So I think, you know, that awareness, and that's why this committee is so important, because there's a real opportunity to learn and to gear up our preparedness, keep it warm. So if, unfortunately, another pandemic did come along, we can pivot readily towards it. So I think complacency is... The second observation is slight elevation in bureaucracy and a tendency for us to go back into our sectoral silos, if I put it that way. Because another feature of the pandemic response was working with the publics. We required policymakers, the academic community, the industrial community, to co-create really innovative solutions at pace. And what I observe is a tendency to go back into our boxes, for want of a better phrase. So I think I have to agree with Tom, we're a B, but we want to be an A. And that's the opportunity for Scotland.
OK, thank you. And have time one more question, Camino?
Yeah.
Just to follow that up, I mean, clearly we see a huge pressure on public services post-COVID, particularly the NHS, a lot of emphasis on NHS recovery, you know, catching up with a lot of what was lost during COVID. Do you think there's a risk, therefore, that, as you say, we take our eye off the ball and we think COVID's done and we don't need to have that drive that's needed? And if I can just slip in a second point to that, where do you think the public are on this? Do you think the public have basically decided that COVID's done? And do you think if we had another pandemic, you would have quite the same public buy-in that we saw during COVID to, for example, restrictions on people's activities that we saw during COVID?
All right. So there's two very good questions. Which one do you want?
I think I'll take the public response. Now, I'm not a behavioural psychologist. I interact, obviously, with the public in my work as a clinician. I think we're privileged and lucky to have some real experts in behavioural psychology, both on the Scientific Advisory Group on COVID-19 and continued into our standing committee. I think what was key was the public response, I think, was overwhelmingly fantastic compared to, I think, what people feared. And, you know, almost overwhelmingly most people adhered to what they were told to do because they recognised the real need. It was spelt out very clearly. Would that happen again? I think it would if it was clear that this was going to have a major impact. Now, I think we've learnt a lot about the four harms. Obviously, we focus very much on COVID on the immediate health consequences of it, but there are clearly other consequences on other diseases, on society and on the economy, which I would say are not devoid of an impact on health either. Unemployment is extremely bad for your health. So I think that somehow got lost a bit in that. So I think people... It's a bit of a crystal ball, but I think people would adhere to what they were told, because I think we do have good channels of communication, and I think there was a huge amount of public trust in those decision-making processes. But yes, you have to be very clear, and you have to be transparent and express very, very clearly exactly why you're being asked to adhere to these principles. But yes, it has fallen, obviously, from the public consciousness. But it will come back, I think, very rapidly should there be a further threat. But that's my personal opinion.
Yeah, so I think we discussed last time the public are the solution, not the problem in a pandemic. And I think the social contract in Scotland was strong, and we should endeavour to maintain that through, you know, we're very fortunate to have deep wells of expertise in Scotland, folk like Stephen Riker, Linda Bald, and they're actually leading work on this. So on the NHS and our question, and our international advisory panel was really useful. If one establishes the skills and capabilities for a really effective pandemic response in isolation, then it won't work. What we need to do is make the exceptional routine by embedding best practice between pandemics and keep it warm. So that's actually looking to Singapore, that's the phrase of their chief scientist. They've had a similar process to us. And it's about having expertise, capabilities, networks that are kept warm during between pandemics, so that that capability is there when, unfortunately, we might need it in the future. So I think embedding it within an efficient, effective, safe health system is the key, rather than seeing it in isolation.
Okay. Thank you. You've raised lots of issues I'd love to explore further, but I appreciate my time is up. So others will come in, I'm sure.
Yep. Alec.
Yeah, good morning. Can I pick up on that point where you said that we're in a better place now in terms of preparedness? And I suppose it's what is it you're actually measuring in terms of preparedness? Because I think, Professor Morris, you did say, and I think you said there again just now, but in terms of the principles of good pandemic preparedness, this was in September, first, a very good, strong health and care system. And for the evidence that we've taken throughout the last year or two, that's what people have told us, is how best can we be prepared? You need a good health and social care system. Now, from what I can see in Scotland right now, the social care system is falling round about itself. Massive shortages, massive burnout of staff that are still there, and then we have record waiting times. So I just wonder, you know, what you're meaning when you say we're in a better position now in terms of being prepared for something, when our everything tells me the opposite.
Well, I can speak to the clinical side because that's where I worked during COVID and continue to do so. Before COVID, I work in infectious diseases, so that's what I do, what I'm trained to do. Most people aren't, and that was a very steep learning curve for those who were at the sharp end of dealing with patients with COVID-19. That has expanded the knowledge base and the training hugely. So we're undoubtedly in a better place than we were. And also that goes for those who work in social care as well, who again had very little experience or very limited experience of dealing with infections on the scale that COVID-19 presented us with. The real danger is that level of training, that level of expertise has to be maintained. And therefore, there is a danger that over time, as memories fade, as new people come and go within the health service and social care system, that expertise will begin to be lost. It's not the job of our committee to operationalise, but we can make scientific advice. And obviously, all the points you've highlighted are very key. And we have to ensure that there is resilience there. So we can highlight the areas, particularly in terms of staff training, both within the NHS and within the social care system, to ensure that is maintained and that there is adequate provision of all the necessary personal protective equipment, the necessary infrastructure and so forth, to make sure that can continue. So it certainly, there are many challenges facing healthcare at the moment, as you all are very well aware. We are in a better place in terms of that general institutionalised memory of what to do during a pandemic. I think the real issue that we have to make sure that we emphasise in our report is that needs to be maintained, because there is a real danger, I think, as Andrew alluded to, that complacency will creep in. But it's not our role to operationalise that, if you see. We can offer that advice, and then it's up to others then to say how that will be embedded in the system.
But if the system's fallen down round about itself, I get what you're saying, that there can be the expertise and the knowledge that you've gained, and that different professionals within health can have that. But if social care's falling down round about itself, if the hospitals aren't coping, I mean, there is another question there that people are asking around. Did we do the right thing when we we shut down so much that we've now got excess deaths, cancer rates much higher, waiting times for operations, people are suffering as a result of all these things. You know, is there a balance to be struck, and did we get that balance right? And the fact that we've come out this side of COVID where health systems and social care systems that are really creaking and struggling.
So those are obviously really important questions. By and large, those will have to be addressed by the relative COVID-19 inquiries. So it's not our role to, I think, comment on or provide evidence about what we did during the pandemic, what worked well and perhaps what didn't. And that will be, I'm sure, revealed in great detail during the various inquiries. Looking forward, I think what we will be keen to provide in our report, and we can't provide everything, but to make sure that we highlight those areas of resilience in healthcare and social care that need to be absolutely robust. And as you say, to factor in the other elements of the non-immediate COVID harms in terms of waiting times, other activities in healthcare, in education and so forth, which clearly were very badly affected during the pandemic, understandably. But it's really for government and other agencies to decide what policies they'll put in place in order to ensure that that is carried forward. But I absolutely agree with you. All those things are really important and need to be, and we will highlight those as important, but it's for others to carry that forward. I don't know if, Andrew, if you'd like to...
Yeah, so this specific role is to look forward, pandemic, future pandemic preparedness, and we have to be sensitive not to comment on issues which are more appropriate for the multiple COVID inquiries, which is another part of my life.
Okay. Can I just finally then ask you, you did say there that you've set up a subgroup to look at the centre and work up the detail. And I think you did say when we talked in September that you were starting to work out what that centre might look like. Would you be able to maybe elaborate on that a bit? Has there been progress made, and what is the thinking behind the centre?
Do you want me to do that?
I'll kick off.
So we've established a group, which is, in terms of the process, established a group, met twice, and in June we're having open meetings, I think one in the Central Belt, one in Perth, to take comments from the community around the purpose and the functions, the structure and the governance options for such a centre. So I think that's moving on. And we hope to have that framing by the end of August. So I think that's moving well, and we're looking to consult openly on how that centre might work. Second comment on it, and actually this came from our international advisory board, they suggested that the terminology of centre is unhelpful, because this, what we're trying to achieve is a collaboration across boundaries. Yeah. So we might actually even look at the terminology. The third comment on this is, because we often get really embroiled in process, but we should be really clear on what outcome are we trying to achieve. So what we really are looking for is for Scotland to be in an excellent place where we can rapidly detect new and emerging pathogens. Secondly, understand transmission, severity, high-risk populations and health consequences. Thirdly, deliver scalable testing, tracing, isolation as required. And lastly, be plugged into an effective diagnostics, vaccines and therapeutics system. And this must all be underpinned by the social contract and working as a team across policymakers, industry, academia. So that's what we want to achieve. And to do that, you need certain capabilities, and that's what the discussion is about in terms of what is our need and what's our current capability and future need in surveillance and diagnostic and testing. You sort of break it down into the so-called buckets or capabilities which we will need to have at our disposal in Scotland. So, you know, and some of those include surveillance, diagnostics, non-pharmaceutical interventions, you know, decision-making structures. So that's the way we're doing it.
Okay.
And we'll make sure you're invited to one of the meetings.
Great. Thanks, Camina.
Yeah, so I think a couple of things. I mean, clearly at the moment we can't tell you that this is exactly how it's going to work and this is what they're going to do, this is their responsibilities and this is the leader. That will happen. At the moment they are clearly in a phase of ensuring that they consult with relevant stakeholders. And as Andrew says, there are a number of meetings planned during June for that. And I think that's really important. I think what we learnt and has always been emphasised by all those dealing with COVID and indeed our international group is that you have to be local to be effective. The most effective responses were in countries that had that very strong local sense of how this is dealt with. And I think that comes through in the Short Life Working Group. They're very much taking that on board. It's not that whole idea of a centre is good in the sense that you have to know who's in charge. But at the same time, you have to involve people who are working at the coalface in terms of local public health teams, for example. And the thing that we've got to make sure is that those very good collaborations between particularly academia and public health that were so helpful during COVID, that those don't, that people don't retreat into their individual silos and say, well, I'm only interested in that. And already I think we've seen really good examples where public health have, for example, leveraged the scientific expertise in the Centre for Virus Research in Glasgow to say, look, we've got this outbreak of really unusual hepatitis in children. Can you help us? We can provide the data acquisition and so forth if you can look at the science of that. And that was extremely helpful and led to the discovery of an unusual and novel virus that seemed to be precipitating that cause. So I don't want to get into too much of the detail about that, but I think that's a good example where the two groups came together. So we want to be sure that I think that a centre for pandemic preparedness encapsulates that joint working together as well, and hopefully very much to bring on industry as well. So I appreciate that's a little bit vague at the moment, but I hope you can see the direction of travel there, and that we very much hope that by the end of the year we can put some flesh on those bones.
Thank you.
Can I? Yep. Because just to add to Tom. An important dimension to this is the industrial science base. So if we look back at COVID, the UK and global response would not have been the same unless we had partnered with the industrial science base. Two examples. Firstly, it used to be called the AZ Oxford vaccine. So the mechanism of using a viral vector to get the immune response was devised by Oxford University. The scale-up, the manufacturing, the quality control, the clinical trials had to be done by industry. Yeah. Likewise, and this is an example Patrick Valence gives, the COVID infection survey. We had some of the best, some of us might have been in it, actually. It was run by the Office for National Statistics. And you'll recall we had some of the best information in the world on surveillance run through the Office for National Statistics. The natural history of that is the ONS had the methodology, but we required 25,000 house visits a week to actually do the testing. And actually that was provided by a clinical research organisation who'd had to lay off their staff because we weren't doing clinical trials. And so those are two examples where we can't ignore the industrial base. You know, effective pandemic preparedness is that really tight partnership.
Okay, thank you. Can I very quickly ask one question, Tom, about what you just said about we need the centre, but we also need the localisation. Does that mean then that local authority health boards would have to have the people in place to be able to tap into it if there's an outbreak in any particular area of Scotland?
I think that policy hasn't been finalised, of course, but yes, the direction of travel is very much towards ensuring that that local expertise that was so useful in the test and trace programme, and in you know, interactions with the various communities. I think that's very much that their desire, and that they're very keen to make sure that that's embedded in the system.
OK, thank you. John.
Thank you very much. If I could, first of all, want to follow up one or two points that you've already made. In answer, I think it was, to Murdo Fraser, you made the point that decisions were made quicker during COVID, and that was generally a good thing. Now, at the Finance Committee at the moment, we're doing a look at how government makes decisions. And on the one hand, we were also told that decisions were made better and quicker during COVID. But the counter was, especially I think from Engender, the women's group, that there was a lack of consultation and women suffered through the pandemic in a variety of ways because that we hadn't spent the time to think through policies. Maybe we didn't have the time to think through policies. So I just wonder how you would react to that kind of comment.
It's a very good point. There is a balance. The pace of COVID was incredible. I mean, I well remember moving from a time when it was a theoretical risk of someone coming from Wuhan to then a few skiers coming back from holiday who were very, very well, to an absolute onslaught of seriously ill people, many of whom tragically died. So the need to formulate policy and to react to it was tantamount. So that's the real need during a pandemic. The downside of that is, of course, as you can say, that without broader consultation, that you might miss things. And as I'm sure the inquiry will reveal, I've no doubt, you know, no one is perfect, and I'm sure mistakes were made. What can we learn about that as we move forward? I think we do have to ensure that there is rapidity in the system, and that's part of what the whole package that we're trying to formulate in our committee is, that those systems are in place so that they can react rapidly. And providing independent and rapid advice to government is very much a part of that. I think it's clear moving forward that we have to understand and actually perhaps implement, because we do understand the differences in health inequalities across the country, not just for women, but in different ethnic groups, those who are less well off and so forth. And we've known about those for a long time, to be fair, ever since the Black Report and subsequently as well. It's not for our committee to decide on that, but clearly we will highlight that, I'm sure. And then it's up for policymakers to say, well, how do we ensure that we can react rapidly, but at the same time not leaving behind these very important
tools? So, is it just inevitable that there has to be compromise in these things?
Yes, in my view.
OK. So, do you want to come in, Professor Morris?
Public participation, involvement and engagement has, I think, shown its value, because it actually allows you to make better decisions. And in the pandemic, I think there are good examples where public involvement at an early stage actually did, despite the need to make decisions urgently, actually added value. The key to it is to have an existing engagement capability in place that you can pivot. So I think, and that's why I'm really pleased that Linda and Stephen are leading our behavioural science group. I think there are things we can do looking ahead for the future that bakes in public participation into the framing and decision-making process.
Okay.
So that's not unique to pandemics.
No, I do get that. There's some general problems out there. And the other side I wanted to touch on was the kind of what we can learn from other countries and the whole international aspect of this. And first of all, I mean, you've used a few phrases already, and I'm not sure if we're talking about the same body. You said international steering group, international reference group, an international advisory panel. Are these different things, or are they the same?
Have I used those three?
Well, between you.
I think apologies then for misleading you potentially there. So yeah, they are all the same thing. It isn't. It's a small but highly knowledgeable group of individuals who we have been fortunate enough to take some of their very valuable time. But also, I think all of us are looking at what. And certainly during the pandemic, looking at what other countries were doing, what seemed to be working, what didn't seem to be working as well. And clearly, what works in country X might not necessarily work very well in Scotland. So you do have to temper that with what we have locally and so forth. And even with the United Kingdom, there are clearly differences in how we deliver healthcare. We have a much more remote and rural population, I think, compared to the rest of the United Kingdom. So there were clearly important differences that we had to take on board. But yes, we are very keen to learn from best practice. And that goes across all the different groups. I'm also on a committee led for the out of the National Services Scotland on antimicrobial resistance and healthcare-associated infection, where we have which has a number of different arms across all areas of different healthcare delivery. But key to that, we've established an international group that is having participants from across all different continents to try and understand that best practice, as I said. So I think it is a really important part.
And where should we be looking? I mean, I think Singapore got mentioned earlier on. Are they a good example of being prepared for the next pandemic? Or, you know, can you point us to any countries which are really on top of this?
I think Singapore would be a good example, amongst others.
Yeah, so context and culture is always important. So Singapore is a case study. It's not the case study, is the way I put it. However, they've done two or three things. They've been through their inquiry process. They've published a white paper. It's being discussed by their parliament next week, I think. And they've very clearly said, this is what we did well. These were the gaps. And they're putting a real emphasis on filling the gaps. And they're also, going back to that phrase, keeping it warm. They've created a pandemic fund called Prepare, of all things. It's Programme for Research and Epidemic Preparedness and Response. And it's an investment. It's about 100 million Singapore dollars over 5 years, which is about 10 million pounds a year. So it's a lot of money, but it's not a lot of money. But they recognised they needed to do that to keep the connections across the ecosystem primed and keeping it warm. We're also learning from other initiatives. You may be aware of the G700 Days mission, which is now being picked up by the G20. The thesis is that, you know, if this was unfortunately to happen again, within 100 days we should have diagnostics, vaccines, therapies. Now that's within three and a bit months. So how do we do that? And that's about targeted investment against the WHO are prioritising pathogens that they think are the highest risk ones. So how do we target R&D across those pathogens? Secondly, especially in vaccines, they're so-called platform technologies. So the mRNA capabilities are platform capabilities. A bit like, do you remember Meccano or Lego?
Yes.
You can tweak it. You're showing your age.
We've already established I'm the oldest member of this committee, yes.
But you can, these platform technologies means that you don't need to go back to the drawing board. You can tweak it based upon the antigen that you're trying to target. And as you know, when we were in COVID, we were targeting the spike protein, but then you can modify it as mutations develop.
So just to clarify what you said, so within 100 days, next time we would hope to have a vaccine?
Well, that is the bold ambition. But saying that, you know, and that's the global ambition, being supported by the G7 and also an organisation called CEPI, which is the Coalition of Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, which is a global. And there is some evidence of that because you may recall that in October there was a Sudanese Ebola virus strain, so Ebola is, you know, is an emerging pathogen, which we don't want. So a Sudanese strain arrived in Uganda, and within 79 days after that outbreak was declared in Uganda, a candidate vaccine actually arrived. So we're beginning to see the ability that if we get alignment, collaboration, joint strategy, we can be globally more. Long way to go, but the G7 100 days mission is something that we should be aware of, and you know we should contribute to it through our Scottish capability plus our partnerships with UK HSA and others.
That's quite exciting. That's very positive. Thanks, Convener.
Can I just add one thing to that? Because the only thing I'd add is that the need for trials, because it's the technology that can be developed now with these platform capabilities quite rapidly. But you do need to know that it works and that it's safe in the real world. Mm-hmm. And that does, unfortunately, take time. Mm-hmm. But I think correspondingly, the fantastic contribution that Scotland made to the vaccine trials means that people have trust in the product, because they say, you can say, look, this is what we did and we tested it and these were the likely side effects at this level and this was the effect. And I think that if you're thinking about vaccinating a population, you have to have those data very clearly, particularly safety. And that does take time. So it's just to make sure that those expectations are managed.
Yeah, well, I think one of my colleagues will be on about data shortly.
can I just say, this session is fascinating. We could run for hours. Would you mind if we go 10 minutes over? Do you have time to go 10 minutes over? Is everybody comfortable if we do that? Yeah? Agreed?
I'm on a meter, but it's fine. We can do that.
We'll speak to the parky. Brian.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Professor Morris and Professor Evans. I am the data geek. I think, you know, when we look at the preparedness is in trying to understand what that really in what that actually means in practical terms. I suppose it's understanding the threat and then their ability to sort of deploy solutions to protect the public. And I think, and to go to the data, it's this ability to gather and assess and deploy data. I think initially would be internationally, because you know when we look back at COVID, we watched it almost this morbid fascination move across the world inextricably towards us. And yet when it got here, we weren't ready. And then the data locally across all of our health boards, our ability to tap into data on the front line in almost in real time. I think, I'd be interested in what your thoughts are, where we are with both of those sort of platforms, if you like, because I think, you know, over the a period of years in working in here, I think it's been a recurring theme that we don't have a platform, really a healthcare platform in Scotland yet that allows us to move around the country and pick up data in real time. I'd be interested to see where your thoughts were on both of those to start with.
Who's the expert here?
So a few thoughts. I think looking forward in terms of pandemic preparedness, we need to see data as core infrastructure. Because otherwise, a phrase I sometimes use is, if one does not have real-time intelligence of how the pandemic is presenting, it's like driving at night with no headlights. But what I think we showed with COVID was how useful it was to use routinely collected data to link it to demonstrate how the pandemic's progressing, who are the high-risk groups, what are the pressures on the healthcare system, how are the vaccines working, are the vaccines safe? Now, there's a myriad of questions that we were able to answer if you've got good data infrastructure. To give you an example, clinical trials are absolutely essential. You can get a vaccine to market having tested on about 30,000, 40,000 people. And then what did we do in the UK was expose it to 40 million, 50 million people. So we need to understand, you know, is it safe? Is it effective in all groups? For example, children and pregnant people, different ethnic groups. And unless you've got a data capability that is linked and accessible, we would be driving at night with no headlights. So Scotland's in an interesting place because it has a good track record of using data. In the pandemic, some of the work that came out of Scotland was truly world-leading, using the term advisedly. I think you met Sir Aziz Sheikh, did you meet? Who will have told you about the EVE2 study. However, the capability in Scotland lacks what I call the critical mass and what I call the ITIs, scalability, sustainability, interoperability, reliability, and security. And what we've seen since the pandemic is that we've regressed, and sometimes it's taking over 200 days to actually access data from some of our most eminent researchers to ask the most relevant questions, because we've not got the data infrastructure and the underpinning governance in place to enable access to those data for trustworthy purposes. So for me, Scotland has a huge opportunity in the use of data as infrastructure for trustworthy purposes, but we're at risk of squandering that opportunity.
So what do we have to do?
Yeah, so just to follow on from some of Andrew's points there, I mean, and to go into a bit more detail, I've been involved in looking at antimicrobial resistance across where I work and also across Scotland in research capabilities. Where the system is good, and we saw some fantastic examples, as Andrew has said, but the real issue for those who want to join up nationally is that the silos these data are kept in are understandably very protected to be sure that patient confidentiality is maintained. But if you want to work across, if I want to look at data from Tayside or Highlands and Islands, I can't do that without going through an enormous set of bureaucracy that is there for a reason. I don't think anyone would dispute it's very important that the public has trust that their data are maintained, but it really hinders that kind of approach. So I think part of what the data group is working on is how do we maintain that integrity of confidentiality while making it much, much easier so that you can go from making a proposal to it being able to be carried through in much, much less than it currently takes, because that's a real sticking point in the system. So I think that I'm sure that's going to come out very strongly in the report.
And we're talking here about crossing health boards here, but we're only 6 million people in Scotland.
I know.
And then when we talk about working internationally as well, so they have to share data with other countries as well. So I think, I don't know, would you agree the opportunity here is to create that environment in Scotland where there are only 6 million people, we can be agile with our data platforms?
I very much hope for. And Scotland has numerous strengths on this. We have the unique health identifier, the community health index number, the CHI number, enables you to link up anyone across Scotland. That's fantastic, and I think the envy of many other health systems. We have very little in the way of private medicine, so most people are enrolled and use the National Health Service Scotland. So that the data is there, if you like, and it's just making sure that we can ensure that scientists and clinicians can access it as quickly as possible, but at the same time make sure that the public trust is maintained, because without that, people are not going to be happy. But embedded in our healthcare system in Scotland, I think we have a real potential to use that, very much so. And, it's not when you're extracting what we call metadata, simple things about age, ethnicity and so forth, those can be absolutely anonymised or pseudo-anonymised so that those working with it don't know the people they're coming from. And I think maybe that needs a little better communication so that when we receive data, we're not actually looking at Mrs. Bloggs for number two. It's actually just a number, but it has that richness of detail that you really need.
Thank you. Thank you. The other thing that struck me there was this international collaboration. When it's a pandemic, it seems absolutely logical we have international cooperation. So I suppose then, if we're going to tackle a pandemic in the future, we need international preparedness, because preparing ourselves, we can be as prepared as we like in isolation, but if the rest of the world are struggling, then inevitably we are going to as well. So where are we globally then with international preparedness? I think on the back of that, this idea of international preparedness, I'm reminded of the scramble for vaccines and how all of a sudden those international cooperations kind of broke down, and everybody, we could say that we were the winners in that, but I don't think anybody's the winners in those kind of the situations. So where are we sort of with international collaboration?
It's not in our remit of our committee, although the point you make is really, really important. Obviously we have the World Health Organization and various other international bodies as well, who have emphasized throughout the pandemic about, I like the expression, we weren't all in the same boat, we were all in the same storm, but we had different boats. And vaccine nationalism, as we saw, I quite agree with you, it ultimately doesn't help anybody. There are a number of non-governmental organisations who've worked in vaccines for many years. There's the Global Alliance for Vaccine Initiative, Gavi, for example, which it works very much in that field to make sure that effective vaccines are available into countries, lower middle-income countries, to be sure that they are then offering. And I think all we can do, I think, in our committee and in Scotland is to emphasise the importance of that, to ensure that that voice doesn't get lost, but to accept that our leverage over a global situation is not huge, but at least we can be sure that we consistently give out that message.
If I have time for one more,
Very quickly, Brian. Okay.
Thank you, convener, indulging me. Just to follow on from my colleague Alex Rioli there, I think part of the preparedness is ability of our system to cope our healthcare system to cope with what potentially comes down the line. I suppose if the same thing happened again, I would fear for those in the front line if they were asked to step into the breach in the way they were the last time. So I just wonder, as part of the work you're doing, you'll be looking after how we look after our healthcare professionals, going forward.
Again, an excellent point. I think I would just say again, we can highlight that as very important. Mm-hmm. It's not the role or the remit of our committee to say how that will be enacted. Mm-hmm. But I think by putting all these structures in place, or recommending that these are structures that we would think valuable, I hope that that will improve the resilience of those who work in the front line. I don't know, Andrew, if you wanted to comment more on that.
Well, I think the principle is that good pandemic preparedness needs a skilled and supported interdisciplinary workforce. Mm. And how we provide those support mechanisms. But you're quite right. We have a pastoral responsibility to our staff. Okay. It's something that we can highlight. But
Thank you. Thank you. We will move on. Stuart.
Convener. Can I just go back to something which was touched upon earlier, and that was regarding the Centre for Pandemic Preparedness. And it was highlighted that about the language used by the advisory board, the use of the word centre. So can I just clarify, are you considering or are you looking at actually setting up a building somewhere as a centre, or is it a bit more flexible than that?
So it's still under discussion. My sense is this is not about bricks and mortar, it's about interdisciplinary expertise and how we create a network that delivers that expertise consistency to all four corners of Scotland, rather than a building. It would be my sense.
Yes, I think the work of that group is very much it's a virtual centre. I don't think there's any aspirations for something in concrete. And that gives it much greater agility because the last thing, in 5 years' time, there will be different technologies, there will be different knowledge will expand and so forth. So it has to be able to respond to that. And I think that's very much their hope.
OK, thank you. And just in terms of this network, I'll use network as compared to centre going forward. So in terms of the network, in terms of the private sector, do you have full support from them thus far in terms of your engagement with them?
So it's work in progress. Private sector is a very broad term. Mm. If we consider capabilities, then you've got vaccines, you've got diagnostics in the data space, you've got analytics, you've got vaccines. So what we're currently doing as a group is challenging ourselves to say, how can we in a trustworthy way have a dialogue with these multiple capabilities? The industrial science base is what I call it, because I don't think, as we've discussed, pandemic preparedness needs to engage that community in a transparent way. And that's something that we are grappling with at present.
And I think to add to that, I mean, we can't tell industry what to do, and clearly they're not charities. They may have very charitable thoughts, but they have to turn a profit. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that we are exploring, one of the things that came out of COVID was rapid development of technology. For example, the wee tests that we all had, the little lateral flow devices and so forth, which were really incredibly important in terms of allowing people then to decide, I need to self-isolate and so forth, and in healthcare, vital that we had those rapid diagnostics. That's a very emerging area and has many applications beyond a pandemic. Every year, the front doors of our hospitals are full of people coming in with respiratory illnesses. Many of them will be influenza, but other respiratory viruses as well. And developing those rapid diagnostics for those groups is certainly something that industry, I think, would be very interested in, and clearly has the spin-off that developing that technology is certainly something that could then be applied to a future pandemic. And the real balancing act is, what can you do now in peacetime, if you like, that maintains that expertise and technological development that can then be ramped up in the face of a pandemic? And that's really challenging. But I think making sure that we keep those interactions warm, that we're able to promote the interactions between healthcare, science, academia, public health and industry, so that they can see that this is something they can invest in now, which in the future. So again, it's a wee bit nebulous at the moment, and I don't think by the end of our report we will have that absolutely set in stone. But I think it's a route map, if you like, that we can continue to follow up on.
The reason why I ask a question, because it's, you touched upon the issue of complacency earlier on. Now, first of all, I mean, the language that's used for the public is hugely important. I mean, there were politicians in this Parliament 12 months ago were claiming the pandemic was over. And clearly, I mean, that wasn't the case. And there are still people going into hospital now with COVID. So politicians have got a role to play. But also in terms of, I mean, with what you've just said regarding with the private sector, and I accept it's a broad term, if there's a kind of a sense of cooling from them, with regards to looking ahead, then I would suggest that's a bit of a concern. And is there, just in terms of that dialogue with them, are they purely just thinking about a profit opportunity in the future, or do they want to engage?
So again, looking ahead, I think it's really essential that Scotland does what I call an environment scan of its industrial base. I think we employ 40,000 people in life sciences in Scotland. In terms of the UK's capability during COVID, we did well in vaccines and therapeutics. We didn't do as well in diagnostics. So thinking through, you know, is there an opportunity in the diagnostics? Saying that, this is a global market. But I think our point is that for excellent preparedness, one needs to, in an open way, discuss with the industrial science base their contribution to various components of what a good pandemic response is, whether that's in the data side of things, whether it's in genomics, whether it's in surveillance, because they have a key role to play. We can't do this all, certainly not from academia or the NHS. So I think that, but how we set those, they would be an integral part, I anticipate, of a future network. How we make that work is something that we're looking at present.
Okay.
And I think just we need to see industry as partners.
Absolutely.
And there has to be perhaps a slight culture shift in how we view socially delivered healthcare versus private industry. And the two can work very well together. Indeed. Industry, in terms of clinical trials and so forth, to look at vaccine platforms, the NHFS, both in Scotland and the UK, offers a fantastic resource to them. So, of course, they'd be very interested in that. And likewise, universities, academia are very good at coming up with blue skies thinking and ideas. But as Andrew said, with the AstraZeneca vaccine, it took an industrial complex to actually scale that up to population level. So we need both. And we need, I think, perhaps a slight culture shift, which I think is already happening, that we can embrace industry, not as the other, but actually as partners in this as well. And many of these things have been developed, vaccine platforms. These new vaccine platforms are already going to be turned to other diseases. You know, people are very interested. Can we make a vaccine against flu that works a bit better than our annual vaccine? Is it something that will be resilient to future variants and so forth? And that goes for a lot of other infectious diseases as well. So I think there's real hope there, but it is a work in progress.
Okay. And I couldn't agree more regarding the partnership approach. Absolutely. And just a final question. Okay. It's regarding the network. And you touched upon earlier regarding an answer to Brian's question regarding bureaucracy. And certainly, so looking at the data and the issue regarding the confidentiality, so the network that's been considered going forward, could that then be the mechanism to then potentially access the data from across the different health board areas in Scotland? Because that could guarantee the confidentiality, but it could also then provide the information that is required to assist going forward with any research.
So I appreciate time, sir. So in brief, I think that is a real opportunity to provide a trustworthy data platform for the population of Scotland that links what I call journeys of care from primary, secondary, tertiary into social care in near real time to answer the questions that we will need for future pandemics. We actually have a vehicle called Research Data Scotland, which has been set up by the Scottish Government to do this, but that's still hitting blockages that we need, 10, 15, 30 approvals for the same study across different parts of Scotland.
Okay. Can I just say that we've actually included this in our long COVID report, long COVID recovery report, that we have requested the Scottish Government update this committee on the work and its delivery and its priorities of health and social care and the data sharing. So it's something that we are actually looking at already.
We were a national health service and we should have a national data capability.
Have you got time to take one very small supplementary from Alec?
Of course.
Thanks. You talk about future pandemic. I've heard people describe and COVID as a once in a 100 years event. So what is the threats? Has the world changed? I mean, what is the threats? And are we likely, as evidence suggests, we are likely to see a future pandemic within our lifetime?
We'll both do this one.
I think if you look back over the last 100 years, we had the pandemic of influenza in 1918-1919. We've had HIV. As a completely novel pathogen, and now we've had, in the last few years, we've had the original SARS, SARS-CoV-2, SARS fortunately not becoming a pandemic, and related virus, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, which again, fortunately, has remained quite geographically localised. Why that's happening, multiple reasons. Essentially, the expansion in human populations, so we're encroaching more and more on urban centres are spreading out, and most of these new infections are what we call zoonoses. They've been acquired from animals and have made that jump from an animal host into the human host. So our exposure to those animal reservoirs is continually increasing. And the second thing is travel. I mean, the numbers of flights and people moving around the world increases year on year as the human population increases. So I think it's always dangerous to make prognostications, but I think the threat is very real, and not just from something we know about. There has always been a bit of a danger to think, oh, it's going to be flu, it's going to be this, but actually it could be disease X, something we've not come across before. And it's very important we take that broad view. Depends on how long you live as to whether it's going to occur in my lifetime or your lifetime. But I think it would be foolish to assume that this is not going to happen for another 100 years. I think there is every possibility that we're looking at future pandemic within the next 100 years, certainly.
Very briefly.
The world's changing. You know, I was born in 1964, 3.2 billion people on the planet. 30th of November last year, they estimated 8 billion people. That plus air travel, climate change, urbanisation, increased human-animal contact. I just think that the conditions for pandemics are tilted towards this being a real risk. We should take it seriously.
I have one very final question for you. I promise you it's a very quick one. You've twice mentioned right at the start of the session the importance of this committee. Which committee were you talking about?
Your.
This committee.
Yeah,
okay, that's all the clarification I was needing.
No, gentlemen, not us.
I would say yours is rather important as well. I'd very much like to thank the witnesses for giving extra time. It's been a fascinating session. If the witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, you can do so in writing. The clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. And that concludes our public part of this meeting. So I suspend this meeting now and allow the witness to leave, and we will move into private. Thank you.